This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Well, today on Dreamland, we have a little bit of a new backdrop back there. You'll see if you look beside my shoulder, the Fool card from Greg Bishop's wonderful UFO Tarot deck. Well, basically, every person, researcher, well-known researcher in the UFO world is a card in the deck. I am the Fool, and I think that's a great thing for me to be because I chose the card because when I started, I had no idea what would happen when Communion was published. And so I was definitely a fool walking off the edge of a cliff with no idea what he was doing. And so that's my card in the UFO Tarot. Today, we've got a really fascinating guest. We're going on a deep journey indeed into the world of disclosure and UFO experience and all sorts of things because we have Jim Lough with us. Jim is has practiced law for 40 years. He was a specialist in municipal and election law, so appellate litigation. So you ask, what's he doing here? Well, somebody came and tapped on his door from the beyond, and that caused him to become interested in us, in UFOs, and to apply his legal skills to the question of disclosure. And we're going to be talking more and a lot about that over the course of the show. Jim, welcome to Dreamland. I'm very pleased that you're here.
Well, thank you. Being a longtime subscriber, I'm happy to be here.
I probably knew, but forgot. Well, good. For once, I'm delighted that another that a subscriber is here. Why did you subscribe, if I may ask?
Well, pretty much I've got every one of your books on the subject. And the key, especially, it speaks directly to me. The master of the key is one of those guiding lights for me, and it has been for a long time.
That's very interesting because, that book, that is really the strangest of all my books. People don't realize it. I've written a few strange books in my life, I will admit that. That one is remarkable. We're recording this during Mercury retrograde, folks. So anything peculiar that happens, like that sound you just heard, just ignore it. Jim's dealing with an ant infestation. All of my usual computer systems are not working correctly. So we're sort of in the usual state. Anyway, that book, that was such an experience. And, reading the book again, going back through it again, I think every single thing he predicted has come true or is coming true. There isn't a single misfire in the whole book. And that's, it's full of predictions. And yet, 99% of these things you read with these predictions in them are complete nonsense. This isn't. Okay, so let's go on. Jim, you are an attorney. You've practiced law completely outside of the context of UFOs. Yet, here you are. But what does that mean? You're an experiencer, yeah?
Yeah, I'm an experiencer. And it's not something when you practice election law or standing up representing the mayor you talk about, because whether how it reflected on me was less important than how it reflected on the client. And yeah. So I kept that quiet. And until about 2013, when I joined Yvonne Smith's group, CERO, I was pretty much kept it in a closet and hidden from the public. So because in election law, especially, not just municipal law, when the other side doesn't have good arguments, they attack the other side personally. And so it's the kind of thing you cannot represent, you know, a public entity about, or any citizens group that may not fall into the category that we fall into. And so I kept it to myself. And in 2013, I started reaching out, joined Yvonne's group, and have been going to conferences ever since, mostly not to listen to the speakers, but to meet with other experiencers, just to see where I was compared to them. And I've pretty much learned that I'm just an average experiencer. Nothing special about my experiences. The experiences are extraordinary, but it's not, I'm no different than you or anyone else that has these experiences.
It's well said. Where we are is we live in the ordinary extraordinary.
Yes.
Or the extraordinary ordinary. Take your pick.
That's the way of putting it.
That's where we are. And it's an extraordinary place to be and a very serious place to be at the same time. So you came, tell us, you know, Jim, I think we need to start with your experience. Why don't you tell us what exactly happened to you? But before we do that, free Dreamlanders, listen up.
This is Whitley Strieber. Listen to me now from June of 2010, talking to Alan Lammers about an incredible thing that happened to him on the island of Sulawesi in Indonesia.
Here you are in South Sulawesi in the little town in the district of Sandu Batu. What happened? You were told something rather strange.
Well, we were told before we went, like my friends that I worked with with the NGO, they told me that when you pack, because it kind of happened by accident, I went out to buy a raincoat. It rains quite a bit in this part of the world. And so I went out and I bought a yellow raincoat. And my friend said, I'm sorry, you can't take that to Walla Walla. And I said, well, why not? And he says, well, you can't wear that color. So anyways, excuse me. So I thought, okay, well, what colors can I wear? They said, well, you can only wear black or white. You cannot wear any bright colors, no bright green, especially no yellow. And, you know, that's all you should bring. And I said, well, what would happen? And they said, well, people disappear.
You will find the rest of that story, and it is brain-bending, in the June 5th edition of Dreamland, June 5, 2010 edition of Dreamland in the unknowncountry.com archive. This archive is one of the richest of its kind in the world, probably is the richest of its kind in the world, filled with extraordinary shows, of which this show is certainly one, this show with Alan Lammers. You will never have heard anything like it. It does what Dreamland is here to do. It opens your mind to the fact that we live inside a hidden reality that we prefer not to acknowledge, but not here. Here on unknowncountry.com, we do acknowledge it. We live in it and we love it. Subscribe today. You can't go wrong. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and get started. There's a new world coming if we can take it. What does that mean? The first part of the message is, if we can take it for ourselves on our own terms. The second part of the message is, can we bear the newness and the huge expansion of human consciousness that is going to be involved? Can we take it? A new world. It doesn't mince words. It tells the good, the bad, and the ugly like it is. And it leaves a message behind. Can you do this? Do you want to? Do we have an alternative? Right now, at this point in history, mankind is either going to get a lot bigger or not. I choose to go forward. I choose to live for and in the future. I choose the future. A new world. We can take it. Available in hardcover, softcover, audiobook, and Kindle.
We're back. We're talking to Jim Lough. His new book, the UFO Briefing Book, you can reach him at jplufo.com. Jim, before we paused for our free Dreamlanders and directed them to buy perhaps a copy of them or Communion or even my new book of poems, I don't know what ads ran, but certainly also to subscribe to this wonderful website. We were getting ready to go into what happened to you. Why did you come into this world? Because you sure weren't in it when you were a kid or even a young man. When did it happen and what happened?
Well, actually, I've been a lifelong experiencer. My first conscious memory was when I was 5 and a half. We were camping and building a cabin, my family and my uncle's family. And we're sitting out by the campfire. And all of a sudden, over the cow pasture next to our property, a large round object appeared and came very close, about 500 feet away from us, and started. The best way to describe it is to listen to Colonel Charles Halt's description of what the Rendlesham Forest object that he saw was. And it was round, it sort of like blinked, it had what looked like dripping metal falling off of it onto a dry field. It was the week before I started kindergarten, Saturday night before I started kindergarten. And I remember looking up at my relatives, and they looked like characters in a Steven Spielberg movie. They were just transfixed and frozen. And that's the last thing I remember. And then the next morning, I go out and around the campfire, all the adults are drinking coffee and talking about the comet they saw. And so to a 5 and a half year old, I assumed the comets just came down like that. And even when I learned differently in high school science, that's not what comets do, I still kept that in my head, that's what had happened. But I remember driving home Sunday night, talking to my dad about it, and the next morning was my first day of kindergarten, and I got up and the first thing I said to my dad when I saw him was, you know, wasn't that comet neat? And that was the term back then, neat. And he looked at me like I was crazy and said, I don't know what you're talking about. And he had forgotten it from that point on. And I have a firm memory of it and it hasn't changed since. And so I had experiences when I was in high school that I remember, and all the way up through adulthood. And it's more remotely or telepathically now, but I've had many experiences, some of which I've regressed with Yvonne Smith, although I'm a terrible regression patient.
Well, me too. I was regressed 3 times successfully. Is that beeping coming from your end?
Yes, and I can't figure out how to stop it.
Okay, well, that's because Mercury's retrograde. As soon as Mercury isn't retrograde anymore, two things will happen. One is you'll figure out how to stop it, and two is it won't happen anymore anyway. So that's where we are now, and that's okay.
I apologize. I'm just back from vacation, which is why I'm still wearing my Grizzly Adams beard and wearing a baseball cap. So sorry.
Well, I want to just mention in passing that there's a video on YouTube, which I'll show a clip of as we're talking, of the very thing that you mentioned. It takes place over a firebase in Afghanistan, and you can see two UFOs with that strange metallic substance falling right out of the bases of them, which is also the same thing that was seen at the Maury Island UFO incident. And it's interesting. It's some kind of technological effect. But what? Just a minute. I mean, but what? We just don't know, do we? We have no idea. So anyway, let's move on from your childhood experience, your first experience. And you were getting ready to tell us about things that happened in high school and a little later. Did anything else happen in your late childhood? And if not, when did it start again?
Pretty much, you know, high school and then through college, it was sort of sporadic. The question is, I don't know when it started and when it ended because I, like most experiencers, I don't remember everything.
I think we remember so little.
Yeah, I've talking to other people that are experiencers, that seems to be the case, is that people don't aren't able to recall everything. Sometimes my thinking is it must be a glitch in the way they do things that we do learn, or maybe it's deliberate. In some cases, I believe it's deliberate. And in John Mack's book, he had one of his books, he talked about one experiencer who was asked them, why don't you show yourselves? And the being spoke and said, you know, we want you to believe in us, but not too much. And I think that sort of encapsulates it.
Well, you know, I think that's an incredibly interesting answer because I know pretty much what I think I know what it means. If they were to walk down the streets, our whole world would immediately turn toward them, what they have, what we can get from them. Everything else would stop. We wouldn't care anymore when we can suddenly realize that these people who are able to do things like moving UFOs and so forth disappear and reappear at will and have so much fantastic control over their world. And if it is even technology so far beyond what we can understand, it's just unbelievable. So we would totally turn toward them. That's called cultural colonization in anthropology. And it's what happens when, like in New Guinea, in World War II, when the Air Force began landing planes on the island, these people had never seen anything like that before and started bringing out all kinds of beer and food and stuff from the planes. They wanted to do it too. And they forgot about their own culture and started making bamboo planes and trying to get beer. That's what we're doing now behind the scenes. That's why there are no human-made UFOs floating around, because we can't figure it out. We're basically building bamboo UFOs at great expense behind the scenes.
Well, Hollywood is a cargo cult, I guess, in that regard.
Well, I mean, the Defense Department's a cargo cult. I'm sorry, it's much worse than Hollywood. Because they are spending a fortune on it. Like the Aurora space plane, which they now claim never existed, they spent maybe as billions and billions of dollars on it. I have a friend who saw it in its test bed, and another friend who was a flight surgeon who was treating the pilots of this thing for busted hips because it had a G counter system in it, where when the plane made a super tight turn, this thing would bang up against their hip to equalize the G forces.
Oh,
and they were getting broken hips. You know, it was there. It was real. There's an electrostatic or a magnetic device in it that enables it to do the sort of falling leaf effect that we see sometimes in UFOs. But it's not anti-gravity. It's a jet. And, you know, there's probably some ideation of it out there that we don't get told about. But it's still cargo cult stuff. You're not going to emulate the functioning of a UFO unless you have that propulsion system, and we do not.
And we've been trying since at least 1947.
At least since 1947. And we need to face the fact that they can't do it. We can't do it. And we've got to do something else. Let's keep on with your story, because it's not over yet. We'll get to the UFO briefing book in big time shortly. But right now, are there any experiences that really stand out in your mind beyond the five-year-old one?
When I was 17, I was playing basketball. It was April of 1970, I think it was. I was a junior in high school. And I was walking home from playing a couple hours of basketball. And instead of going home, I made a right turn and went to a park and decided to lay down, which was sort of stupid because the park was still growing grass. And so I laid down as sweaty gym clothes on, laid down in the ground that had mulch on top of it. And the air, as soon as I lay down, the area just got dead silent. Completely silent. And so I looked up. I was living in San Dimas, California, which is east of Los Angeles. And I looked up and I saw not an object. I saw sort of a hole in the sky, it looked like to me, because it was a starlit night, no moon, but I could see pretty well. And this lenticular shaped object or something that was blacker than the sky was moving towards Los Angeles. And it was near an airport, Brackett Field. And so I was thinking, wow, what a weird time. Brackett Field's closed at night. They didn't have night landings. And then I couldn't see it. And I'm going, wait a minute, I can't hear it either. And so I thought to myself, okay, it's not a helicopter. It's not a plane. And then I started thinking to myself, it's a UFO. And before I even finished the thought in my head, the object did a 130-degree straight edge turn towards me and started heading down. It was probably 3,000 to 5,000 feet up in the sky and started heading down in a straight line right towards me. And so I stood up so I could get a better view of it. And it just kept getting bigger and bigger. And I reached down and grabbed a rock. And without looking, I just reached around the ground, found a rock. And when it got close enough, it looked like it was maybe 50 to 75 feet above my head. I threw the rock directly up in the air at it. And it missed. It didn't hit it. But the rock came down and nearly hit my head, coming right back down towards me, and I never moved. And so when it got to me, it appeared to just keep going and going into the mountains, the San Gabriel Mountains behind me. and it disappeared. And so just like that. And so 50, 60 years later, whatever, I am regressed by Yvonne Smith about the incident. And I don't really see much. But after she did the regression, I was going to drive back to the San Diego area where I live. I decided to drive through San Dimas and stop at that point. And I stood at the spot, and I remember the UFO passed over. It was about 30, if it was 75 feet in the air, it was 30 feet around, typical lenticular-shaped, round, flying saucer shape. But it was just, but there were, I couldn't see this. It was like the absence of light. So I'm standing at this spot, and I remember clearly watching it go over a water tower. And I looked around behind me, and there was no water tower. And then I looked over to my right and saw the water tower. And then I realized, wait a minute. 1 millisecond, I'm facing one way. The next millisecond, I'm turned another way. And so instead of going straight behind me, it went like this, and then a right angle over to the northwest. And so I realized at that moment, it just hit me just like that, that the I had experienced missing time where they put me back facing a different direction than I was. And it was a subtle difference, but it took me 50 years to make that connection. And so I don't know what happened, because Yvonne couldn't break past that point. She always teases me that I'm a lawyer and I have trouble following direction.
Yeah.
Probably she's correct in that regard.
Well, this is an absolutely classic example of missing time. You know, I was once had missing time demonstrated to me. It was years ago in Paris. I was had fallen ill, and my family, we were in an apartment. This is long before Airbnb, in Montparnasse, and I was not able to go touring that day, so I had to stay in the flat. My family left. And a few minutes after they left, there came a knock on the door. It was two men, and they were very polite. They said they were French intelligence officers, and they said they would like to interview me when I was in the state that I thought of as missing time. And I said, well, how can you do that? And they said, well, we can induce it. It's induced with sound. And I said, well, I'd like a copy of the interview then. He said, the man said, no, I can't do that, but I can let you listen to it. But I want to warn you beforehand, to be honest, you will not remember it for long. And they had come in, and we were standing now in the apartment foyer. And I said, well, I thought to myself, I'm not going to pass this up. At least I'll be able to listen to it. And I figured I'll remember it all right. So I said, okay, I'm game. Let's do it. And he said, would you like to listen to it? I said, yeah. And he said, okay. And he started with this little tape recorder he had, rewinding it. And I said, what are you doing? He said, we did the interview. There was no gap at all.
Like it.
And listen, do you know what this means? It means that this could happen anytime. We don't know who we are and where we are. We don't know. Anyway, long story short, I did listen to it. I figured I would remember it. Now what I remember is only this, and I've remembered this ever since it happened. It made me extremely happy. I felt wonderful. And I don't know why. Early the next morning at 5 a.m., when my family came back from the day, I told them the whole story, of course. My daughter-in-law had to go to the airport very early. And I went downstairs with her to help her get a cab. I obviously wasn't going to let her go out on the streets of Paris at 5 o'clock in the morning to get a cab by herself. And there were the two guys sitting there in a little Mercedes on the roadside, on the street. And they laughed, and they were laughing. And I waved at her and I said, "Julie, come over. Let's talk to him." And they just drove off.
Oh my.
I don't know who they were, French intelligence or not. No idea. Isn't that a great story, though?
Amazing. Amazing. Well, that fits with what, you know, happened to me. And I'd like to tell two different stories that, if I could. One relates to you, and one was when I was in Paris one time. The one that relates to you is I was doing one of my three regressions with Von Smith. And we were doing it on a particular instance in my life. When I was 48 years old, I was covering a council meeting in a small town called Sanger, California, outside of Fresno, where I lived. And I got home about 11:30. It was a late meeting, a very contentious meeting. And so I went in the walk-in closet and changed so I wouldn't wake up my wife, went to bed. And the next thing I remember is I wake up and say out loud to myself, "So that's what they look like." And I was standing on the sidewalk out front of my house in my underwear. It was cold. It was in October. 98. And I looked at the front door and realized, you know, I can't just stand here in the cold. I've got to go in. And I was hoping, oh, I hope the door opens. And so I was in light that was brighter than sunlight. Yet I didn't look up. And I just walked towards the door. And I'm thinking to myself, I've got to remember everything about this. And I open the door, go in the house, get in bed. The next morning, I didn't have to go to work. And so I slept in. About 8 o'clock, I woke up. And the entire world was spinning. And it wasn't spinning like this. It was like the entire world would shift to one side to the other, then go back again. That's a particular kind of vertigo. And I was like that for 2 weeks. I couldn't drive.
Oh my goodness.
I couldn't drive. And when I finally could focus, you know, I went into the doctor's office, and the doctor just gave me some anti-nausea medication and sent me home. And so for 2 weeks I was like that. When I woke up, when I finally could focus, here, I'll take off my, when I finally could focus, if you, let's see, it's this side, yeah.
Yeah.
I knew how it went left from right, I wouldn't have been a lawyer. I would have.
See it a little bit.
Yeah, here we go. Okay. You see, I've got a scar coming down right here. You see it right there. And I had two scars. Okay. See?
Yeah, that's fine, Jim. We probably won't be able to see it, but.
Okay. Well, I had two scars there, and I couldn't figure out what was wrong. So fast forward after the regression, I'm trying to figure out what I learned about it. During the regression, my eyelids were shut, but I was able to see through a little slit in my eyes, and I saw the top half of an alien, classic gray, big eyes, that kind of thing. And so the alien stepped back from me a little bit, and then I saw this with my eyes shut, I saw this motion going this way, like sort of over my eyes and my forehead. And then something was happening. I could feel something happening. And then about 45 seconds to 90 seconds later, it went the same kind of motion, looking like sort of a boomerang, went the other way again. And so I couldn't figure out what that was. And Yvonne, it was unusual for Yvonne too. And so when I come home from the regression, I was going to read a book. You know, I always read to go to sleep. And I didn't have a, I just finished a book by half the time. And so I didn't have a book. So I went to my bookshelf. And what I do is I look for, when I don't have any reading material, I look for bookmarks to see where I stopped in a book. And I picked up Communion Letters and looked at a bookmark, and the bookmark said November 1997, because it was the receipt from the bookstore when I bought your book. And so I started reading from that point. And I read about three pages of one chapter and then went to sleep when I got to the end of that chapter. And the next morning I got up, it was Monday morning, and I started reading the next chapter over breakfast. And it was about a person that had written to you and mentioned that they were abducted, they were taken aboard, and a boomerang type object was waved in front of them, and it split their skull open at the exact same point as mine, as where these marks are. And
I'm so amazed.
At that point, they in the letter, the gentleman said that they put some sort of like ruby type, you know, plastic, you know, glass or whatever objects inside his head. And then the boomerang type object was waved over him the opposite way, and it closed up his wound. And I'm going, that's exactly what happened with mine. And I would have known about it ahead of time, about this thing, if I'd have finished your book. Instead of just, you know, I just set it in the shelf thinking I'd finished it, because it was not, you know, they were just different letters. Everyone was different. So
the experience you had happened after you stopped reading the book?
Yeah. The next year. Okay. I bought the book in November.
You read at that point, then you have the experience. Then you take the book down and start reading again. And there's the other person's experience.
30 years later. Yes. The 30 years later.
30 years later.
I was triggered by what I saw, the bits. I just saw bits and pieces in the regression.
So, you were triggered by the regression. And this is like something, some presence or force is helping you put this memory together, weaving it together and using the book as a tool.
And that tells me they can go backwards and forwards in time, because I stopped reading the book almost a year before I had the incident, and then didn't discover it till probably 2016 or so.
Now, listen, free listeners, I have been so riveted by this, and I'm sure you have been too. I forgot the second break, so I'm going to tell you what might have been in it. What might have been in it is a beautiful commercial called Stars, which is, it reminds you of the wonder of unknowncountry.com and the joy of exploring it, which is a huge, extraordinary website filled with stuff like this. I mean, there's no place like it in the world. And then there probably was a commercial for them. And if you haven't read them yet, now is the time, because what the kind of things Jim is talking about are exactly the kind of things that are analyzed in them. Okay, Jim, now that done, the commercial that isn't a commercial, let's continue on. I think we're getting to the point where we might start talking about your book, the UFO Briefing Book. And let's go ahead and start talking about that. And but if you want to weave in, unless there are experiences that you haven't touched on that you would like to talk about.
There's a new world coming if we can take it. What does that mean? The first part of the message is, if we can take it for ourselves on our own terms. The second part of the message is, can we bear the newness and the huge expansion of human consciousness that is going to be involved? Can we take it? A new world. It doesn't mince words. It tells the good, the bad, and the ugly like it is. And it leaves a message behind. Can you do this? Do you want to? Do we have an alternative? Right now, at this point in history, mankind is either going to get a lot bigger or not. I choose to go forward. I choose to live for and in the future. I choose the future. A new world. We can take it. Available in hardcover, softcover, audiobook, and Kindle. Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. Unknowncountry.com. There's no place like it in the world.
The book's very comprehensive, and it's called the UFO Briefing Book for a very specific reason. And it's basically the work of an attorney. Now, we're shifting gears here. This is an experiencer. He's also a lawyer, and he is now using his legal skills in order to further the interests of us experiencers and every single human being on planet Earth. So, Jim, first, give us an idea of what made you decide to do this. Why did you decide to write the UFO Briefing Book?
Marco Rubio, in July of 2020, issued a request to the UAP task force of the Navy for a report on UAPs. And once he did that, I immediately dropped everything I was doing and decided to write what I thought was going to be a long paper on what Congress will get from the Pentagon and what they need to do about it. And so I was going to just write a paper, but once I started pricing out how much it would cost me to send 150, 200 book or papers to Congress, I looked into self-publishing a book, and that was actually cheaper. So I self-published the UFO Briefing Book A Congressional Guide to the UAP Phenomena. And a friend of mine who's a retired city manager, he was one of my first people that read it, said it reads like a 128-page staff report. Because what I did is I went through a little bit of the history of UFOs as it relates to the government and Congress, not just general history about the subject. And then explain to the members of Congress that I sent it to that the Pentagon will slow walk everything to you. They will not give you anything without, you know, having it pulled literally from them by surgery. And that here's what you're going to need to do. And so I made some recommendations. One is you need to strengthen whistleblower protections. Another is you need to change FOIA to allow for, you know, the presumption that UAP information should automatically become public unless there's a demonstrated clear and convincing evidence of a security reason to keep it quiet. And then I went through a couple of other things, pretty much all of which have ended up in legislation. I finished the book in March of 2021 and got it to members of Congress in March and April. And it laid out the history of how Congress has been kept out of this subject, relying very heavily on David Jacobs' wonderful book, UFO Controversy in America, written in 1973 or 4, which was
That's a brilliant book, by the way, but go ahead.
It is. And so I walked through what they need to do, and I sent it off. Like I said, I sent out 300 copies of it. At least 200 of them went to Congress. And I also sent a few to private people, one of which I sent it to Harry Reid. I was thinking, I'll never be able to find Harry Reid's retirement address. And so I went on Google Maps, and it just popped up just like that.
Wow.
And so I got his home address off of Google. You know, and so I sent it to retired Senator Reid, and he's the only one that got back to me. And he wrote me a personal note saying, this is 3 months before he passed, saying that, you know, the book was well done, done well. He used old English. It was done well. And he thanked me for my interest in the vital subject. And so, but the congressmen and senators I sent it to, I didn't hear from any of them.
Yeah, that happened to me when I sent out them to the congressmen and senators. You know, they talk the talk, but I have a feeling these guys ain't walking the walk. So, free Dreamlanders, we have reached the end of our time together. And I would like to say, I would, as always, thank you very much for being with us. To remind you, Jim Lough's website is jplufo.com. His new book is the UFO Briefing Book. And why don't you get a copy? Send it to your congressman and tell them, and senators, and tell them, get on the stick. Don't ignore this. Don't let it pass, and don't let the Defense Department drag its heels, which it is doing, dragging its heels. Okay, thank you anyway, Free Dreamlanders, for being with us. We'll see you again next week.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber.
Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.